Good evening, and welcome to the what's becoming an annual event in Cape Elizabeth, a opportunity for both the town council and the school board to come together very early in the budget season to put our heads together and try to struggle together in the midst of the difficult economic climate that we are in this year. As you probably know, most of us, we have the school board and the town council somewhat intermingled here at the table. And the format this evening will be the following. The chairperson of our finance committee, Janet McLaughlin, will begin the workshop with some prepared comments and discussion of the municipal issues with regard to our budgetary process. And then Mike McGovern, our town manager, will offer some of his thoughts. Michael will be followed by Peter Leslie, the chairperson of the school board's finance committee. And afterward, Connie Goldman, the superintendent of our schools, will follow Peter. We'll then invite any and all participation from this in long table here, I guess. But at the same time, as we're speaking, we'd like to keep it relatively informal. And if any of you who have come in this dismal weather would like to make some comments or ask some questions, please feel free to do that in the context of the remarks that are being made. Sometimes if you wait till the very end, you'll not ask the question you wanted to ask. And then we will, at the end, offer an opportunity for anyone to offer their opinions and input with regard to this important process. Having said that, I will now turn over the evening to Councillor Janet McLaughlin.
Thank you, Wayne. Wayne stated that I was going to make some prepared comments. Most of you know me well enough to know that they won't be very long. We're hoping not to be here too awfully late tonight, but we do want to have a very good discussion to set the groundwork for what's going to be a very difficult budget year. We did start this process actually a good three months ago. The council in a workshop decided that we did want to renew this kind of format early on so that we can have input both from the council and from the school board and from their staff. We have found this valuable in the past. We expect to find it valuable again this year and extremely necessary in this difficult budget year we're facing. I think what we're hoping to do is lay some groundwork, get out some factual information for everybody so we can address both the short-term and the long-term necessities that we're going to be dealing with in the budget issues. When I wrote to Jan Solon in October suggesting that we have this kind of workshop, I said I wanted it to be one with the workshop to help set the foundation so that the budget process is going to be one in which we base decisions on as much factual information as possible. I'll keep coming back to that probably. Unfortunately, because of happenings that are outside our control, much of the factual information we wish we had in our hands, we don't. And I know we're all very frustrated by that. I think I can speak for everybody at this table, which I will certainly refrain from doing a lot, but we're going to do our best in spite of the hardships that we're working under and the restraints that we're working under because of the state situation. One thing we were hoping to have in our hands this evening was a coordinated five-year capital expenditure program. I still feel that's a very valuable document for us to have in the process of planning and projecting the budget. It gives you both short-term and long-term information. There are always reasons why we don't have something. Peter Leslie and I discussed this the other day. I certainly understand the reasons he put forth. I still think it's a very important goal for us to keep, is to create that kind of document as soon as possible so that we can look at both sides of the budget, with the school side and the municipal side, and do our planning based on looking at both sides, not one entity looking at one side and the other entity looking at their own side. We will, during the course of the evening, talk about a number of issues. One that is going to come up is the labor costs that we are all facing. It's nothing that we can keep in the background. It's very much in the forefront, and I want us to be as upfront as we can tonight with where we think the labor costs are going, where they should go. I believe our ultimate goal is going to be to come up with a reasonable and responsible budget and do the very best that we can to balance our wants and our needs and our ability to pay for those. I'm going to let Mr. McGovern.
Thank you very much, Janet. Thank you. Michael.
Thank you for that opening, Council McLaughlin. As I understood the purpose of this workshop, in part, it was to give everyone a sense of what we may be facing this coming year with all of the different budgets, but particularly to look at the areas of revenues and to look at expenditures, what we see coming down the road. On the municipal side, I think it's perhaps most important to look back at what we went through this past year. I think there's been quite a few people have forgotten that the municipal budget actually saw a reduction in real dollars this past year. The specific reduction was that the current budget is $284,864 less than the budget for fiscal year 1991. That's not less than we hoped for. That's not less than the rate of inflation. That is an actual real dollar deduction. That's 7%. The budget went from almost $4 million down about $300,000 to just under $3.7 million. So we, as you know, the school department has as well, have been looking at cuts right along. It's nothing new in Cape Elizabeth for a whole lot of years. This past year, the town went through the cuts that were in last year's budget, plus we also went through a recent budget session during the month of December. This past year, to give particularly the citizens a sense of what was reduced, training for municipal employees was reduced 50%, or $3,400. Conferences and meetings was reduced about $8,500, or 43%. The council had been setting aside some money for the land acquisition fund, just short of $50,000. That was totally eliminated from the budget this year. Building maintenance was reduced 10%. Road resurfacing, just trying to keep the roadways smooth, was cut in half, $40,000 down to $20,000. When I first came here in Cape Elizabeth in 1978, we were spending around $55,000 on road resurfacing. In 13, 14 years, we managed to reduce it by $35,000. Minor equipment and tools, the odds and ends that we need to get the work done, reduced 28%. Sidewalks, something that I think everyone, you know, particularly with kids, understands the importance of, was reduced 80% this year, from $10,000 down to $2,000. Outlaid, all the normal replacement of equipment, the more major projects that we try to do, the budget reduced at $128,000, or 69% below the level it was a year ago. Roadway drainage reconstruction, the more major road projects, that fund was cut in half, from about $153,000 down to $78,500. The money at Fort Williams, we had been setting aside $60,000 a year to do improvements at the fort. That was cut in half to $30,000. We have one less police officer this year than we had last year. That was essentially happened by eliminating the full-time detective position and instead having other one officer work half-time as a detective and half-time as an officer. There was a policing program that went on at Kettle Cove that was eliminated, about a little over $5,000. The town report was reduced 37% from $2,700 down to $1,700. The Public Works Department lost one of their equipment operators for a savings of $22,400. We reduced a summer maintenance worker at a savings of just short of $4,000. Family Fun Day was reduced $5,000, and cable TV was reduced $5,000, the expense for that. In addition, in December, the council took $90,000 of the roadway drainage account. They used up their whole contingency account of around $12,000. They recognized some savings at regional waste systems for around $20,000. Funding was eliminated for a fire department deputy's position, which became open and was not filled. Now the funding has been eliminated for it, so it couldn't be not, so it would not be filled. The council conference account was cut further. This is beyond the percentage cuts I mentioned earlier. Fort Williams was cut another $20,000, so we went from $60,000 to $10,000 in 1 year. The family fun day account was cut further, office supplies, more conferences and meetings, part-time payroll in areas, library purchases, tree maintenance, fire department training. These are all small amounts. They're not large dollar amounts, but it gives an idea where the cuts are. The Buster, the K-9 dog was eliminated. An art museum contribution was cut, $500 cut totally, and a few other cuts as well, altogether $200,000. If you look at both the $200,000 plus the $284,000, it's a total of $484,000. That's a reduction in real terms of, or actual dollars, of 12.2%. To equate the magnitude of the cuts this past year, if the school budget had suffered the same reduction, it would have been a cut of just over $1.4 million from the budget the school department is now operating on. If the state had to cut its general fund by the same percentage, the cut would be approximately $419 million from the biennium. You know, the state hasn't even begun to look at numbers like that. So that's what has happened up to now. We've already seen, you know, substantial cuts, 12%. You know, last year inflation was up around 6%. This year, fortunately, it's down around 3%. But we have seen a whole lot cut. We recently did finish a budget impact schedule for next year, looking at projects, looking at revenues. That shows that we can expect an additional revenue decline of about $170,000. That's primarily because of declines in the rates that the town earns on its investments, as well as having less money to invest, as well as a reduction in state revenue sharing. It is based on that we would receive 3.1% of the amount that the state collects from sales and income tax. Obviously, the governor hasn't released his budget. We don't know yet. In the most recent budget, he proposed totally eliminating municipal revenue sharing. If it was totally eliminated, we would lose another $220,000. In addition to the $170,000 loss, we also have some what I would call virtually uncontrollable increases in spending. We have already incurred debt service last year and the year before that we have to begin picking up some principal payments that were deferred until this year. That amounts to $60,000 that we're obligated to pay back. It's not new debt service for anything that's yet to be done. That's existing debt service that needs to be paid. The hydrant rental fire protection charge, right now we're paying $122,000 a year. The water district hopes to increase that by 74% over the next 3 years. Already has put in a rate increase of 18% that was delayed because of the petition that started here in Cape Elizabeth. But nonetheless, you know, if the PUC orders those rates, they're there. Third is street lighting has gone up over 15% this coming year. The street lights cannot be removed because they have useful life left. We cannot save any money by removing street lights. You look at those two areas, so it's an additional $120,000 that cannot be eliminated, that cannot be cut. You add the $170,000 revenue decline with the $120,000 in uncontrollable expenses. This means that if we don't receive any additional support from the property tax, the municipal budget would have to be reduced another $300,000 in addition to the $300,000 that was reduced this past year. We have a labor contract in place that provides a 5% salary increase. It's the third year of a three-year contract to our police union. If that is not renegotiated, we would need an additional $100,000 in cuts when we look at the entire municipal budget. So that's $400,000 altogether. But that's something I know will be discussed perhaps later. The real difficulty is the $300,000 cut this year would have to come from a much smaller base, and we don't have the things to cut again that we've already cut once. You know, the land acquisition fund was cut out; it can't be cut again. Outlay has already been reduced by almost 70%. There's not a whole lot more that we can cut there. All cuts this coming year would really have to come from direct services and from the manner in which direct services are provided, and that is through personnel. If we, this is based on the $300,000, the personnel cuts would be in the vicinity of 8 full-time municipal employees. Well, that is 1 in every 5 full-time positions. I'm not saying that we would necessarily do that, but, you know, unless something gives, that is really unavoidable. So, you know, of just over 40 full-time positions, we would lose 8 of them. You know, that would mean we'd be unable to have 2 police officers on the road at all times. You know, I could go on and on. I don't want to have scare tactics. But at the same time, you know, when you're looking at reducing a budget by $600,000 over 2 years, you know, it's particularly one as lean as our municipal budget is, and when we have so many fixed costs, you know, it's just about impossible to do. In the budget impact schedule, I think everyone on the council and the board received a sheet that shows just how lean the municipal budget already is. I believe it was probably the last sheet in the budget impact schedule. We looked at per capita income for Cape Elizabeth and for similar communities. Cape Elizabeth spends for each citizen for municipal services $415 per person. Cumberland spends $577, Falmouth $627, Freeport $452, Scarborough $771, Wyndham $362, Yarmouth $721, and Gorham $454. The mean of all those is around $550, just short of that. If Cape Elizabeth, for its municipal services, spent at the mean per capita level for all of those communities, the total municipal budget would be $4,850,000. Our budget currently is around $3.7 million, or we're $1.1 million short already of the mean for the per capita spending for the communities in the area. So I think, you know, that really shows how tough it is to cut a municipal budget when you already have so many fixed costs and you are already so lean. That is the outlook of what I see for revenues. And the budget impact schedule, you know, we also showed all sorts of additional projects that should be done, maintenance that should be done, equipment that should be replaced. I think, you know, from what we'll be hearing from the school department later on this evening, when you know, that we look at the impact of the school space and the condition of some of the school buildings, it really doesn't pay to keep deferring maintenance and deferring taking care of your infrastructure. And you know, I really would hate to see us, you know, reduce the municipal budget and not take care of any infrastructure at all, because, you know, we would, in the end, it's just going to cost the citizens a lot more than what it otherwise costs. Specifically, what I'm recommending to the town council is that we not continue to defer equipment maintenance, building repair, and infrastructure maintenance, and that we return, that we try to sustain the services at the current level. In order to do that, I believe at an absolute minimum, it would take a 3% increase in spending from what we received last year. What I'm asking for is a total 3% increase over 2 years in spending, or an average of 1.5% per year, which is well under the rate of inflation. What that would mean is a budget of $4.1 million. That would require from local property taxes $2.6 million, or 27% of the total amount of current taxation. If you looked at that simply as the municipal side of the budget, forgot about everything else, that would be a tax increase of about 25%. Obviously, in this economy, you know, no one is going to support a tax increase of 25%, and I would be run out of town if that came into place, and I'm sure the council would be as well. Anyway, but if you look at the entire budget, because we're such a small piece of it, even a 25% increase in the municipal side for taxation would still only be a 4.4% tax increase in the entire budget. You know, but I recognize, as well as everyone, that education has always been the top priority in this community. It always will be. So I did do some calculations that if the other budgets, community services, the county, and the school department received a 3% increase in taxation, almost up to the town level, but not quite, then the total tax increase would be 6.7%. Even a $4.1 million budget for the town would still require a reduction of $700,000 from the projected amount that the budget impact schedule shows is needed. You know, that still would require a whole lot of budget cutting. If the municipal side of the budget was given no tax increase for fiscal year 1993, from what we should have been doing, not from the current budget, but what the projection shows we should have been doing, we would need to reduce $1.3 million from the budget. And what we should be doing are the routine equipment replacements and all those things that are listed in the budget impact schedule you all have. The $1.3 million equates to the entire budgets for the police, library, and public works departments. You know, in order to get down to the level, you know, where if we didn't get any more revenue, would we, you know, cut out, we would have to cut a total of $1.3 million, which equates to that. You know, that's not going to happen, obviously, but, you know, if it did, the town government would simply collect taxes, pay debt service and insurance, provide hydrants, street lighting, maintain its property, pay trash disposal fees, conduct elections, put out fires, meet the needs of the poor, help pay for human services, and dispatch fire and rescue vehicles. There would be no plowing and police protection. You know, obviously, the council would not let that happen. And it's not what I would recommend, but I really want to give everyone the sense of an outline of the magnitude of the problem. You know, I realize, you know, it's going to be very difficult for the council to accept a tax increase this year. I realize, you know, difficult for the citizens, particularly, to accept a tax increase for this year. However, at the same time, you know, I was at a meeting today of the managers in Cumberland County. The manager of New Gloucester was speaking, and he was talking about what did well at Christmas, the different businesses, and he pointed out that he had read about L.L. Bean had a very good year. And the reason that it had a good year, particularly the Christmas season, was that they provided quality at a reasonable price. And, you know, my fear is if we don't provide quality municipal services at a reasonable price, and I think, you know, it's a bargain right now what we're providing, I think, as the numbers indicate, but if we don't provide reasonable municipal services, the entire municipality is going to suffer. The school system, community services, the town, because, you know, if people don't feel comfortable with the police protection in this community, if they don't feel comfortable with all of the municipal services, they're going to get a very poor attitude toward the municipal government, and I think it will reflect on everyone. So, you know, I would hope that as this process continues, that everyone will remain cognizant of not only the economy that's out there that I realize is real difficult, but also that you know, if we don't do something about the municipal budget, we will really see a decimation of municipal services during the coming year. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Michael. Not certainly good news, but real numbers that we've just got to struggle with. Well, Peter, you've been telling us yearly that compared to our fellow municipalities, it's a bargain live in Cape Elizabeth. Please cheer us up from the point of view of the school board.
That's a tough mandate, and that's a tough act to follow, isn't it? But I'm going to use some slides, so I think we have to have the lights turned out, and I have to see if I can operate this machine.
Well, Peter's getting ready. I have a summary of most of what I said, and I'll distribute that maybe when he's done, but if you look right, didn't want to have everyone shuffling through papers.
Is that working?
Fine.
Not used to doing this in a mirror. I'm going to have to take this in sections. Can everybody hear me all right?
Yes, it's fine, Peter.
And is this okay for the TV? What this is a summary of a much longer analysis that we've done of this year's budget and an attempt to project it into the future. If you look at the very top, which I will locate in a minute, right in there, you'll see a percentage, 3%. That's just an assumption that we would continue to spend for salaries and benefits and our other operating expenses an amount probably slightly under the inflation. Inflation is predicted by many economists to have settled down at around the 4% level for the next few years. That, of course, requires a crystal ball. But so we've projected that amount, and then we've taken this year's budget. And you'll notice there's a little box up there that says cumulative, not added 92, 93. That's an adjustment for the projected increase of students, which we expect next year to be 59 students. And we calculated very roughly that the marginal cost of accommodating those students would be 50% of the previous year's cost per student. And you'll notice the number in the box is zero. We feel that we can accommodate that increase without an additional expenditure this year. But then in the future, the amount is added and it's cumulative because the numbers, as you can see, 44, 45, 41 additional students each year obviously are going to require some additional expenditure. The next significant number for next year is the $200,000 right there. That's the cost of moving either the kindergarten or the eighth grade to the high school. And we have to do that for space considerations, plus an estimate for the architectural and engineering fees that we would incur next year as we prepared for a building program and a renovation of our buildings. So you'll see, now I'm going to try to move this, see which way it goes. Okay. I'm sure your eyes go immediately to the bottom line, so I'm going to go there too. The percent increase in the tax rate, 8.88%. Another assumption which we make, and it's a heroic one, is state aid. This year we started out thinking we were going to get $2,078,000. It looks like we're going to get $1,933,000. And we've estimated that we might conceivably get 3% more, not because the state's necessarily going to have more money, but the southern communities are expected to benefit from the school funding formula in the years to come. So if we had to, if we followed that and we and all those assumptions came true, we would still need, on our portion of the local tax rate, an 8.8% increase. And just running across that bottom line quickly, you'll see that the next year it drops down to 1.89%. And that's because the $200,000 one-time expenditure disappears. The building program hasn't started, so debt service has not kicked in. So that's a major difference. Now I'm going to try to get another one up here. Okay, we'll start at the top. So we asked ourselves, in the context of an 8.88% increase in the local tax rate, what would we have to do to get the tax rate increase below 1%? And so you'll see at the top, the inflation adjustment is 0% for the next year. You'll notice that nothing else changes except that in the middle of the page, right about here, cuts needed to reduce taxes. Let me come back to that in a minute. I push this up here. Everything else stays the same. And the tax rate increase is only 0.75%, 0.74. Go back to the middle of the page. Cuts needed to reduce taxes. $300,000 would be the amount required. And bear in mind that instead of increasing our expenditures 3%, we've left our expenditures for salaries and benefits and for operating expenses at zero, no increase, and we've had no adjustment to accommodate the 59 new students. That could mean a number of things. That could mean larger classes, it could mean a pay freeze, it could be a significant reduction in personnel and programs, and I'm going to ask the superintendent to comment on that in a few moments. I'm not very good at this, am I? Councillor McLaughlin referred earlier to our difficulty in having a long-range capital expenditure program. The problem is really that it's not that we don't have one, the problem is we have six. And you can see them B, B1, C, C1, D, and B1 revised. These are the present options that we have for dealing with our building problems. The price tag varies quite a lot. See, the grand total ranges from $7.9 million at a low to $7.5 million, rather, to $10.6 million. So the school board is in the process of trying to make that decision. As you can see, that is a very big number. That would mean if we were to do the most expensive and if we were to get, say, $2.5 million of state aid for some of the new building that we are considering, we would take our debt service from the present level of about $166,000 a year to a little over $1 million a year within 4 years. And that would obviously increase the tax rate, unless we made cuts in program, which is a little hard for many of us to envisage. Now that, we have copies of all of this, incidentally, which if you're interested, we will deliver to you. Now, unless you have some questions, I will pass the microphone to the superintendent.
Thank you very much, Peter. Connie, did you want to speak from where you are? Do you have?
No, I don't have slides.
No slides, okay. You're on.
You don't have good slides.
Well, at the moment, I guess I have more. I could say it better and just summarizing a little bit. I did bring with me for all members of the town council. Board already has received these. Perhaps you received them from your, if you have children at the K-8 level, we did distribute those to classes today. Hopefully they took them home. I'm not sure if you may have one here, but we have others, and I'm happy to make those available. What this sheet is a reminder to parents and obviously all community people. But we do find, obviously, that this particular issue, parents are going to be probably most vitally interested. That reminded people we have a board meeting next week and a special meeting on the 21st of January, specifically the 21st meeting, focusing on decision the board must make for next year. That is, we are out of space already, regardless of any considerations for renovation, building addition, or any of the other recommendations that Peter just summarized up there, B and C options. We haven't got enough space to put the students that we will have, K-8, in the Pond Cove and middle school complex. Therefore, we must move one grade to the high school. This is something that was discussed in our workshop, or at least referred to. Now, of course, it's a focused decision. Frankly, we could, I suppose, also come back to the council with a request for portable. I think in our preliminary discussions, we've decided we probably won't come back with that particular request. The fact of the matter is we have to have space. However we go about that, and Peter's summary of projected figures, although arguably the figure will not be exactly what he has in his what-if sheet, it is going to cost us money. We either have to modify certain pieces of the high school for appropriate kindergarten space. We move eighth grade, the cost for modification is more minimal, but we run into increased costs on the fact that we have so many shared staff members at the eighth grade level that would require duplication of services of one kind or another. And we will be discussing those all of those problems in more detail. There is no way that we can do any of this without additional adjustments. Furthermore, one of the things that we have mentioned a number of times as we've gone through our building study is the whole issue of handicap access. None of our buildings are in compliance, and that includes the high school, which was in compliance 20 years ago, but is not, frankly, in according to current code. We may well have to deal with some of this because there's a new law that's now operative, 1992, to say nothing of the laws that are already on the books, and we simply must deal with those issues, some of which are really quite expensive. I think that as far as commenting on what Peter was saying about, can we absorb this? Can we cut enough programs that already exist in order for us to simply say we will shift our priorities from educational programs to debt service for construction? It frankly is not possible to accomplish what we have ahead of us to do that. I do have to say, along with Michael, that there would be whole chunks of programs that we now have that would go if that were the burden that we had to deal with. Even if we were to up all of our elementary classes to what the state recommends at 25 level that we've talked about a number of times, even if we did that with all of our elementary classes, reduced some offerings at the high school and so forth, we would actually only be able to cut a few positions because we have additional students. If, in fact, we can build a budget this year that balances, as Peter's figures indicated, what it is predictable that it will cost us to take care of the additional students we're going to be seeing, that will be a major achievement. So the idea of cutting on top of that is, I think Michael is explaining quite well. We did cut a lot last year. We cut out over $200,000 worth of a variety of academic positions, some of them administrative positions, and reassigned and merged programs, and in case anybody has forgotten, I do have last year's budget with me to sort of go down through that, but I think probably remember in general that we've done that. And as Michael also said, you could only cut those positions once. We didn't reinstate them, we don't have them, so any additional cuts are going to come from additional programs. Furthermore, this is a fairly small school system with a fairly concentrated kind of program. We don't have numerous alternative education programs. We don't have buildings scattered around, one of which we might close and merge. All of those options that occasionally are used by school districts to try to consolidate and save money are simply not available to us. I'm in the present part right now, I'm collecting my budgets from the buildings. I've had preliminary discussions with principals about their staffing needs for next year. We have looked and will continue to look very hard at any program that for any reason or other, no matter how valuable it may be, that seems to be somewhat peripheral to the major goals that we have set for ourselves. But there is no way that we are going to be able to cut our educational program sufficiently to absorb all of the debt service costs that we're going to incur. I realize that this is a serious problem. I would like to say in sort of summarizing, however, referring again to Michael's figures, one of the things that I will be doing as we get in my own budget, the building problems we face are not faced by us alone. All the districts around here, all the school districts around, if you look at the debt service line, you will see hundreds of thousands, and it's not uncommon to see in a district about this size over $1 million in debt service. School debt service is hovering around $200,000. I mean, it was frankly, as a superintendent coming in last year, and I looked at the budget and saw the debt service line, I thought, we either have solved our problems or we haven't addressed them yet.
Connie, would you explain to the viewers what debt service really means?
Yes, that, specifically what I'm referring to in a school budget is what typically, it's like a mortgage, actually. I mean, in other words, when you are either major renovation or capital improvements, or actually, of course, building, usually is floated by 20-year bonds. And therefore, in your yearly budget, you must put in the both the principal and interest, similar, of course, to what one has as a mortgage. Although debt service is in a school budget for a variety of issues, for instance, repairs of one kind or another, and the $200,000 we have in our budget is paying on the bond for the rather extensive roof work and some work on maintenance of the buildings and some handicap accessibility pieces that we have already accomplished. Frankly, the budgets of most of the districts around here reflect the kinds of building programs that we are now facing, and at some time when it seems appropriate, I will produce a chart that will show you what those comparisons are. As I have said many times, these buildings are not really neglected buildings. There may be some pieces of one kind or another that we could say was deferred maintenance. It might have been better had they been done sooner. We are facing a national problem with our infrastructure of school buildings that were put up in the 50s and 60s. They were oftentimes quickly put up because of the baby boom, the window wall construction, the flat roofs, the rather, you know, obviously by today's standards, extremely inefficient single pane windows and so forth and so on. I've seen estimates of just billions of dollars facing the American public to deal with these school building problems. So it's any consolation, it's not just a local problem. So in summary, I would simply say that, as Peter has indicated, we are going to make every effort to absorb through prudent trimming and making the best of any resources we have to do what we can to absorb the extra students that we will be seeing next year in next year's budget, instead of just automatically assuming that they will each cause us to raise the budget by the per state or per pupil expenditure. I don't think we can do a lot more than that based on what we have done last year. The other issue of going for state construction aid, I have had Ted Ruhr from the department down, and he is encouraging us to put in the applications, but when I explain this to the board in a regular board meeting, that's not going to pay for the buildings. It will pay for a part of it, and it will be a rather slow and unpredictable process, but obviously we have to go through anything that we can to mitigate the cost. Be happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Connie. Thank you. My only other thought, Jane, Counselor Amaro, we're privileged to have the chairperson of the State Board of Education with us. I know I perhaps caught you a little bit off guard, but you've been sort of representing the Board of Education throughout the state over your tenure as chairperson. Any thoughts as to what might be happening to help or hinder us over the next year, but perhaps even over the next 5 years, as we struggle, I think, as a community with the whole issue of class size and numbers of programs and those kind of issues that we all struggle with together year after year, from the point of view of what mandates, help, hindrance we may be getting from the state?
Well, I guess this is one time when we're fortunate that we don't depend for more funds from the state than we do, because they certainly will not be forthcoming. I think everybody realizes that. We would be lucky if we could maintain what we're receiving this year, because I think that the communities that traditionally are high-receiving communities are going to attempt to find a different way of distributing the funds next year, which could endanger the funding for the low-receiving districts like we are. As far as mandates, there will be no new mandates, for sure. If anything, existing mandates are being waived, as any community can make a case for not having the resources to carry out the mandates, they can receive a waiver from the commission. Beyond that, I think the one hopeful story might be in school construction money. That is the one area that the state has not reduced during this whole budget crunch. We are going forward with several school construction projects this year, and I think it would be behoove us to apply for those funds, even though the process might take a little longer than what we might want to do. It certainly would be worthwhile, I think, because those monies are still there. I guess that's about all.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, perhaps at this point I can open up the discussion to the rest of the respective boards here in terms of input, comments that anyone would like to make at this time. Rosemary.
Yes, I had a comment probably for the town manager, a question. Michael, could you tell us what the approximate bond rate available to the town of Cape Elizabeth might be right now, and if there's a difference in a jumbo bond versus a, you know, $2,000 or $3,000 bond, you know, like an $8 or $10 million bond, is that discounted further? And
the finance chairman of the school board is just as expert as I am in this. I've looked at the Wall Street Journal yesterday. Municipal bonds are at their lowest rate in 10 years, probably, or more. I think the 10-year notes were going for about 5.6. What'd you say?
I didn't look at it yesterday.
Well, they're going for about 5.6, and then the longer life bonds were slightly higher than that. But they were down. They had gone up a little. Now they're back down again at the lowest that they've ever been.
I guess incidentally, Rosemary, made the projections of debt service that I had up on the wall there a little while ago based on 6.5%. And since the interest rates have fallen, I would say, let's say 6 to be conservative, but probably under 6, there would be a slight savings. Well, actually, it wouldn't be so slight. It would be closer to $75,000 a year if those rates were going to continue through the 3-year period that we would be taking down this new debt.
Peter, the news is so awful, I mean, from the point of view of revenues and the recession. Again, your own financial background perhaps would be helpful in explaining why at this particular time it would be a good time to build.
Well, it would be a good time not only to build, but it would be a good time to borrow, because these are historically low interest rates, as Michael suggested, and I don't think there's anybody in this room that doesn't know the situation of the building trades. People would be delighted to build buildings for us at this time and renovate our buildings, and we would be getting, I think, again, a historic opportunity to get the lowest possible square foot cost. So you benefit two ways, and in very important ways.
Is the intent of the school board at the January 21st meeting, is a decision going to be made about what option will be chosen?
Well, I don't know if I should speak for the board, but it's my understanding that our major decision for that evening is which grade to transfer to the high school for next year. However, I have been saying to people that I think it would make sense to make that decision against a backdrop of what, which of the two strands of the options would be favored. There are B options and then there are C options. The C options essentially speak about changing the high school from a 9 through 12 to a 7 through 12, although it would be seen as a combined upper middle school kind of configuration, etc. It still makes that building a 7 through 12 building. The B options keep the grade configurations much as they are now, a K 4, 5, 8, and 9, 12, with a certain amount of variation depending on what extra swing space is made or extra use is made of swing space at the high school. But the B options essentially go with that decision. So as one of the things that if we decide to go with an application to the state, which I certainly agree with Jane, I think all the advice I'm getting is that that makes sense. We do have to make a decision in general terms whether we want a B option or a C option. We don't at this point have to make an absolute decision, but we would need a direction in order to put in the applications.
Other comments from board members?
Mr. Chairman?
Please, Charlie.
From the town's side, scenario, looking at the second year of the biennium, it appears that we're going to be in as much of a shortfall as we are now. They're projecting at least, what, $150 million, even into the next biennium. The loss of any kind of revenue sharing for the rest of this first year of the biennium and the loss in it if they do not fund revenue sharing for the second half, that's the worst scenario for you from the state, correct? Or is there, you know, are there other areas that they could cut?
You never know the worst scenario for the state anymore. There isn't much now. There isn't much more they can cut. Yeah, but revenue sharing, you know, in our budget this year was a revenue of $347,000. The state had told us we should budget $414,000. We knew better. But even then, we're still falling quite a bit short of even a little lower projection as a result of the cut.
And our revenue sharing was our entire contribution as our portion of the Cumberland County budget, with a couple of thousand dollars difference. That's the magnitude of what that involves.
And your projection of 170 in local revenues, that could possibly be worse.
It could be worse than that.
Councilor Cogsell.
I'm going to turn the table on you, Councilor Cramlin. As the representative on the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee, can you give us any inkling as to how much they might be expecting from us next year, or how much that budget may increase?
Well, actually, I was just notified today there's going to be another public hearing January 21st. I believe that's a Tuesday at 4 o'clock. I think the commissioners continue to want to receive more and more input. I think the fact that revenue sharing really became another axe in the municipal treasuries this year is forcing the commissioners in the county to relook at wage increases, projected wage increases, and the entire story with which they have to deal with their roughly $10 million budget. So again, for any and all that are listening or here, there's still further time to give input to the county and to our commissioners. Dick Hughes in particular represents Cape Elizabeth, because a final decision, in my opinion, has not yet been made. We were looking at roughly a 6.5. I don't know if Debbie Pizzo is around here, but she always has the numbers. Do you remember exactly our proportion? It was in the last council packet. Roughly 6.5% increase was the projected increase, and we just thought that was absurd given the nature of money matters these days. But that's not firmly established yet. I can't do better than that, Phyllis.
That's very good. Thank you.
Well, perhaps at this point, there are a variety of people in the audience that may have questions or confusion about what's happening here. Mr. Adams, you're always good for input.
This is not time, but I'm gathering facts.
All right, fair enough. Fair enough. We'll expect to hear from you at a future date.
However. I'd like to go back to something Mike Michael harped on, I think it's most important, we cannot compromise public safety. That, I think, is a given. We may be able to get along with roads that are a little bit more slushy, may be able to cram a few more people into the high school, but I think public safety becomes number one for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, and I hope that we keep that in mind. I'm thinking of the stuff that's done behind the scenes, people don't even know about. I don't know how, I don't wish to comment, I don't know how many alarm systems there are in the town of Cape Elizabeth. I venture to say there are a tremendous amount of alarm systems. And speaking about public safety, I would not like to have the road patrolled by one policeman working on a traffic accident and a couple alarm systems go off. I don't think we should go back to the days of Mr. Perkins and his white, what was it, a Packard or a Cadillac?
Cadillac.
The police chief drove his own white Cadillac, and that was the town's police protector. I mean, we can't go back. But I just want, as far as I'm concerned, I think public safety is number one.
Well, we're all getting hit at once. It's a tough time. The council is going to be debating next Monday night the whole issue of the purchase of a new ladder truck for our fire department. As citizens probably are aware, the ladder on the aerial ladder on our fire truck currently has been, I don't know, Billy, is the word condemned? What's the right word when you can't use it?
It's a problem.
And we just simply can't rely on neighboring communities to use their apparatus in an emergency. That's a potential expenditure in the ballpark of $400,000 when you buy a piece of equipment like that. And certainly we've been putting it off and putting it off and putting it off for, gosh, the last 3 or 4 years anyway. A couple of years?
No, it hasn't. The ladder truck purchase has not been put off at all. The truck was totally refurbished about 10 years ago. They put a new truck under it, put a what's now about a 40-year-old aerial on top of it. It's the aerial that has been condemned. The ladder under it's fine, but apparently under the current National Fire Protection Standards, we can't just plop a new ladder on top of the existing truck. I would like to mention, since you brought the ladder truck up, that all of those dire numbers that I presented really don't include money for the ladder truck. That's, you know, an additional problem that needs to be faced, and that it is proposed in the budget impact schedule that it be bonded, but it's one of those things that we wouldn't really be incurring the cost until the following year. But again, it would be something we would have to face in fiscal year 1994.
Here.
Before I was speaking, for the school board, or at least for the finance committee, I would like to make a couple of personal observations, if I may. There are two very, very significant pieces of paper in front of me, and I regret to say that neither of them is mine. But the first is the town manager's analysis of our per capita spending as compared to our neighboring communities. And I think those numbers are very compelling. We're at the very bottom of the scale, which is unusual in a residential and relatively affluent community. The other document is a copy of an article that David Broder wrote about a town which Councillor McLaughlin placed in front of us, which describes a town in California which tried to determine what the people wanted. And I think that bears careful study and reflection. My own personal view is that the items we've been discussing tonight, such as police protection, such as the elimination of spending on our sidewalks, fairly minor, but nevertheless an item that caught my attention, and our schools. My view is that the police protection and the amenities, such as the sidewalks and open spaces, and the schools have a direct bearing on the value of our property. Now that's perhaps stating it rather bluntly, but what I'm suggesting is that if we don't spend money on these things, we will be shooting ourselves in the foot. And as I said earlier, I do think this is a historic opportunity to spend some money, borrow some money, and spend it on our physical plan. We're a lightly taxed community, according to the town manager's figures. We're also a lightly indebted community. And the state of Maine, incidentally, by national standards, is not very heavily indebted. The state could also take this opportunity to do significant borrowing to put people back to work, to improve our deteriorating infrastructure. But we're not here to talk tonight about the state of Maine. My view is that this is an opportunity for Cape Elizabeth, to avoid being timid, to really take the long view and look at our future.
Rosemary.
Well, I just have an observation. We tend to look at the high school as a very beautiful and perfect, and we often call it underutilized building. But I just think for a lot of people in the community, they don't realize that it's already 20 years old. And what's going to happen soon is it's going to start needing some of the very expensive repairs, if not properly maintained, both in a preventive and also on a schedule basis. So I just think that that's very important, because when people look at the high school, some of them think it's, you know, 10 years old, and, you know, it's 20 years old. And I just think that that's important in terms of doing something for the immediate students that are in the school system in the Pond Cove in the middle school, but also because if we don't do it, everything is going to need a geometric progression in dollars to fix for every year that we wait.
Charlie. I guess I have a question for Mr. McGovern. In looking at setting a tax rate and in looking at what this community can bear, how has the economy hurt, how has the economy affected this community in the increase in uncollected real estate taxes? I think we need to know that.
Yeah, I haven't looked at it lately. This past year, it reduced our undesignated fund balance by, was it around $120,000, I believe? My sense is that this year, things are going along at about the same pace as last year, in part because of the real bad economy. We've had some arrangements where monies have been coming in that we usually wouldn't get. Banks have been paying them, and, you know, when they're about to foreclose, so we're catching up a little. But overall, I think we're holding our own. I did another community, one of the councilors meeting tonight or in the next day or two, and it's where that is an extremely significant issue, and to the point that they're looking at reducing their budget from now until June 30, including that and revenue sharing, but particularly that, about $250,000 in one of these towns that was on the comparison sheet. So it's a really good question, but Cape, people seem to be paying the taxes at least the same rate they were last year. That's it. Deborah Pizzo handles it more than I do. But.
Other input this evening from anyone? Billy?
I would just like to say, and I'd like to ask someone in the school board, is the difference in the percentage of funding that the town would get in new construction over renovation, for one question. And also, and maybe Jane could answer this one for me better, that due to the way the economy is and being an election year, things change on election year, and around the state house, is there any feeling that the federal government is going to pump the money into the state, or the state pumps the money in to fix some of these buildings, and at the same time be putting some people back to work? Because, as Connie said earlier, there's a lot of school buildings around the state of Maine that needs to be renovated, and also they would be more energy sufficient buildings, in my opinion.
Well, the federal government does not give states any money for school construction. But the state of Maine realizes what Peter said earlier, that this is a good time to be building new schools, because we're building them cheaper than we've ever built them. So the money's going a lot further, and the needs are so great. To your question about a new project versus renovation, there is much more money available for new projects. In fact, there's very little for renovation. The only money that you get for renovation is if you're going to renovate the whole school, the whole building, or if you're going to do a small special project. So that money is much more limited. However, there are many more people that are on a list, there's a priority list in the state for new school projects. And right now there are 50 school districts on that list. We're probably going to be able to build 7 or 8 this year.
Jane, if you put in to the state for the money then, and there are 50 and they choose 7 or 8, and you're 51st on the list, by the time they get to you, have you missed your window of opportunity for the good interest rates that are available
now? Possibly, but each year a new rating system is done of the project. So that doesn't mean that this project, if it came in next year from Cape Elizabeth, would be 51st. There's a very strict rating system based on the on safety issues, on overcrowding, and on new programming. And a new project that comes in is rated against all of those standards, and it could come in right at the top of the list, depending on what the needs were. Or it could come in, you know. But like I said, Cape Elizabeth is not the only community in the state that has severe needs in the area of school construction.
The only way we'll find out is to put the application in. Again, I'll be explaining this in a little more detail next week for the board, but what we really have are 2 projects, one of which we would prepare for in April. Application, because you're only allowed to put it in once a year. The other one at the November. The middle school application, especially if the decision on the board's part were a mix of new construction and renovation addition as outlined in that B1 modified, would be called a regular project. It means it's a larger project. We'd be putting that in April. The Pond Cove, it would be called a special project because we essentially would be going after the new construction of the gym, which is a program space, which makes it a pretty classic special project. We also would be putting in for the degree that we can negotiate with the state on renovation of the Cove, because there are some issues in that building that would probably be covered in that kind of thing. And then there would be in both projects. Renovation is not usually paid for by the state, but of course that is cheaper than new construction. And the other thing you have to understand, we're about a 29% subsidy state. So a state local approved project never brings in more than what the percentage of your subsidy is until you hit the circuit breaker, at which point you get more. But that's all, you know, I'll be charting that out for people so I can be a little clearer about it. But it's pretty clear to me now from the conversations that I've had and the various, my own understanding of these issues, is that we ought to put in those 2 projects as I've outlined, and you'll be hearing a lot more about that as we go through the process. We do have to come to the council for your backing for the project. We go to the board and then to the council.
Charlie.
I had asked Mr. McGovern before the meeting started if he could enlighten me about Wyndham's approach at budget, and maybe he can enlighten the whole combined boards.
Wyndham is emulating a budget process that began in California. The manager out there by the name of Ted Gamer, I think it was Visalia, California. And they have a system called Expenditure Control budgeting. And what that does, essentially, it looks at the inflation rate each year, and it also looks at the growth. How many more students do you have? How much more population do you have? And the councils have generally decided that if you look at the percentage increase in both, that will be approximately what the percentage increase in the budget is each year. That's begun as a base, and it's to try to, in my sense, to avoid a whole lot of debate on it. So, but I'm not sure if that's necessarily true. But what it does, it assumes that you start with everything equal, which, you know, maybe isn't necessarily so, but it does assume that. Beyond that, any departments that have money left in the budgets at the end of the year can keep them rather than turning them back into the general fund. Any departments that can generate revenues can keep their own revenues. And the sense is that every department would become a lot more entrepreneurial than they otherwise would be. If they could save money and get their own benefit from it, then they might be more likely to find ways to save money. That's the basic outcome. Mm-hmm.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Janet.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've done a lot of talking so far this evening about some good long-term maintenance, and I thank Rosemary for bringing that up. It's always been one of my main concerns, especially if having once walked the roofs of the school buildings. I'm very tuned into that. And we talked about buildings in general. I think one thing I'd like to have us do now is do some thinking and talking about the personnel that we have and do some talking about our labor costs. My understanding on the school side is that you are going to be negotiating again because you're in a one-year contract situation. Okay. The one union on the town side that we deal with is the police union, and they are in a three-year contract.
Entering
the third year of a three-year contract, and I believe there is some concern on the council about that situation with our police union and what we need to do about that. I easily foresee the council going back to the negotiating table with the police union because of our contract situation with them. Very often, as you all know, that it is the unionized wage increases that run the wage increases for the rest of the personnel, town side, if they're not town side, and school side, if they're not unionized. And I think that's something we have to look at very carefully this year. My reading of the town at this point, because of the economic situations, is that I see that there's a growing disparity in the citizenry income. People at higher salaries in this town, a lot of people at higher salaries in this town are staying at those higher salary levels. We have a lot more people in this town becoming unemployed or having to go back into employment at a lower level than they were before. I see a widening of the rift between people's incomes in this town. I think that's something that I just need to put out. I'm going to be very tuned into that, and I hope other people will also.
Where do you find that information? I'm just curious.
I find that from talking to a lot of people around town, and a lot of people around town in different labor sectors. Yeah. We have people employed who have quite stable positions where they're still getting annual raises. We have other people who are being laid off with very little warning. We've, you know, friends of mine who've been unemployed for over a year and a half, still trying to stay in this town for very valid reasons in their minds, not knowing if they can afford to. And we have to stay aware of that. I don't know if you're only as strong as your weakest link in that kind of situation, but you certainly have to keep that weakest economic link in mind. Going back a bit to the labor situation, I don't know what kind of conversation the school board has had about going into your negotiations with the teachers union. What I would hope is that at the very least, whatever we come up with raises, wage increases for one entity will be the wage increase for all entities in the town. And I'd just like to hear other people comment on that kind of situation.
I guess everybody wants to it's a tough issue to discuss publicly, particularly on the eve of negotiations. I know, for example, that I and some of my fellow board members will have two meetings on Monday with the two of the bargaining units, one being the largest one, the teachers. And our past practice has been to go into the opening session and basically exchange ideas, at least in the last few years that I've been involved in it. I found that a very favorable way to start the negotiation. To have to comment now on some of the things that I and some of my colleagues would say, I think would be, in the context of formal negotiation discussions would be inappropriate. But I would be pleased to have a discussion with you, for example, in a more private forum. There's certain, I'm not quite sure how your bargaining units are organized, but we have certain limitations about speaking in public and speaking to the press while
too.
The negotiations are ongoing. You do also?
Certainly.
Yeah, so yep. I see the press is present.
I can see the television cameras.
If I might, in defense of Mr. Leslie, I think if members of the school board did say very much, they could be subject to an unfair labor practice for not bargaining in good faith. So I would
thank you.
Caution them all.
Councilor Cogswell.
Well, I just hope in whatever negotiations are conducted in any forum by any group, that benefits, particularly medical benefits, are very seriously considered. The town pays a lot of money for the benefits. I think we're all going to have to start going the way of business and having the employees contributing more for their own benefits. There's a minimum benefit, and they can elect other benefits, but not to have everything covered by the employer.
Well, I guess tonight we've...
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. Charlie.
Just to make one comment, as a board member who is one of the negotiators, we have five bargaining units, all of which will be bargaining for a new contract. We as a board, I think, are aware of the economic situation. We as a board are aware of the loss of funding, and I think our counterparts are also aware. So I think we have to give them credit. And we will also take credit. So I think it will be a responsible bargaining session from both sides.
I just wanted to make a comment for the people watching, and that is, having been on the town council and going through the town budget and the school budget, I will tell you I'm very sensitive to the fact that at $400,000 hit on the town side is not equivalent to a $400,000 hit on the school side, and I just want to keep that in mind in every decision. But I also am a person who believes strongly in quality, and that perhaps if we choose an option that is a little bit more expensive in the initial outlay, it may not necessarily be the most expensive option in the long term. And that is how I will be basing my decisions on almost any issue that would fit into that situation.
Please, Loretta.
Mr. McGovern, the homes in Cape Elizabeth are in some cases depreciating in value. And I think people are finding that out when they're they're going in for a loan, and they're getting an appraisal back that's considerably less than they're paying taxes on. Do you foresee that being a problem with the assessor, with if they come before the assessor? Could that be a significant problem, or?
It is a bit of a problem, and that's why the town assessor recommended to the council a while ago that we begin a process of a revaluation next year. Unfortunately, to get started would cost about $25,000. And, again, it's, do we want quality assessments or not? I would assume that we want quality assessments. We're going to have to bite the bullet and pay for them. But, we can't do it if we reduce the budget by $300,000, $400,000. It just becomes an impossibility. But it is a problem. If you don't go ahead and do a revaluation, what you tend to do is getting people through the door all the time, and your valuation gets trickled down without the benefit of readjusting the tax rate at the same time, and with the additional problem of those that squeak the loudest are the ones getting the changes, rather than being fair and having everyone adjusted to an appropriate level. Actually, at this point, most of the values are pretty close to the values that we had back when the last revaluation was done in 1987. We've had some problems, particularly with condominiums and in a few other areas, but for the most part, we're back to the 1987 levels. We went up about 20%, and now we've gone back to where we were just since 87.
Well, certainly it, Jane.
I almost hate to bring this up, but I think one thing that we ought to be aware of is that presently the state funds 100% of the employer's share of the Maine State Retirement System for teachers. And that is a lot of money. It's about $140 million. And I just wonder at what point that's going to become an issue. I think it will at some point. And it's something that we ought to be at least have in the back of our mind, because right now, as a community, we do not have to pay into the state retirement system.
Another point, Wayne, and trying to predict what Augusta may do, what the legislature may do, just a slight anecdote. Back in December, when the big budget bill was passed, reducing the state budget, they promised that any excess revenue, but they didn't promise, it's the law, that any excess revenue above the governor's projections during the rest of the fiscal year would go towards municipal revenue sharing. Well, they met in special session earlier this week, and they agreed that any money that was saved as a result of being different from the governor's projections would go into helping distressed school districts. So they've given away the same money twice, and it's money that probably isn't going to exist anyway. So, it's we are moving into an election year, and I don't think we can predict too much what they will do. And sometimes I wonder if they know what they're doing themselves.
Well, I think for everyone tonight, we've really heard that it is really the best of times to bond, but the worst of times to look for revenue. Our work certainly has begun. The major day that the town council would be delighted to hear as much input as possible from citizens would be Saturday, March 21st. We spend pretty much all day, that's Saturday, from 8 in the morning till about 6 o'clock at night, reviewing all of the accounts on the municipal side, and certainly I would offer an invitation for anyone to join us at that point. All of our meetings are open to the public. We'll be meeting with the school board on Thursday, March 26th, tentatively anyway, at 7:30 p.m., as our charter requires each year that the budget adoption must take place by May 30th. We have a lot of work ahead of us. Thank you very much, respective boards, this evening, and thank you very much for watching. Good night.
Thank you.
Elise.